Our next speaker, I'm really excited about because I am literally his biggest fan. And I just love this guy so much. I think he's beyond brilliant. And he is going to be talking. Well, let's bring him up. Oh, there he is. Oh, I love this man. And I can say that he's my husband. So we he is going to be talking about turning a 10K flip into a $100,000 deal. It's our favorite type of deal that we do. Chris is very much the numbers guy, so he's going to run you through this. And take it away, my love.
All right. Thank you. I have a 45-minute presentation that I have to condense down to 30 minutes. So I will be talking very, very quickly. First, if you have done a real estate deal before, a wholesale deal, a flip, if you got a rental property, Airbnb or whatever, drop a thumbs up in the chat. Let's hear it. Most people say they want to get involved in real estate, but they never do. And so if you've done a deal, like you're in the game, or at least you've played the game and you've got the knowledge and experience you have is just amazing. So drop a thumbs up in the chat, give yourself a high five. But if you're brand new, you can be that person that's done their first deal. So if you're brand new and you're excited about doing your first deal, drop your favorite smiley emoji. I've talked a lot about emojis today. I love emojis. So drop your favorite smiley in the chat. Want to hear from you. I love comments. So I'm going to show you the strategy that Jamie and I use, and we used specifically to turn a $10,000 flip or would-be flip into a $100,000 deal. And by the time I'm done, you're probably not going to want to flip houses anymore. But your bottom line, your financials would be much happier because of it. So you're going to see the actual numbers of the deal, and I'm going to show you a couple other case studies of six-figure deals that we've done. And then at the very end, if we have time, I'm going to show you an actual plan of action on how you can become a real estate millionaire. So let's light it up in the chat. Let me know if you want to see that. I'm going to speed along. So I got started in real estate back in 2004. I was a broke college student, had no job. There I am sporting. I've never been a fashionable guy. Jamie reminds me of that. But it's true. So here I am sporting cargo shorts, Abercrombie shirt, and high socks and some tennis shoes or whatever. But hey, I'm 21 years old or so, and I just bought a house. So I don't care. May not look good from a fashion standpoint, but just bought a house, did my first deal. Amazing. Ended up flipping four houses within that first year in real estate while still in college. And I did that all through joint ventures and using private lenders. Brief background of our history. So in 2011, Jamie and I got married, and I dropped this bomb in her lap. She tells the story a lot better than I do, which she tells it in her upcoming book. But basically I said, hey, babe, I want to start flipping houses. We both had jobs, and what we ended up doing actually was buying rental properties. Really a good idea at the time. Then in 2014, got licensed. 2015, went full time. 2018, joined EXP Realty. And that was because it was a company that I saw that allowed me to build wealth and passive income within my business and while I invest. And so it aligned with our goals and made just complete total sense. And then having all these extra collaborative opportunities has just been amazing. 2020, Invested Agents was born out of a local event. And then 2021, we took a huge leap into a large multifamily. And we bought a $42 million, or we're small partners in a $42 million asset in Florida. So all in all, $65 million in transactions over the years, $19 million raised from private lenders and equity partners, $44 million assets under management. Most of that is because of the apartment complex, same with the 393 units. And again, we're small partners on that. It's not like we took that on ourselves. 200 flips, top 0.5% with EXP Realty. This is a picture of my why. It's why I get up every day before 5 a.m. Sometimes on Saturdays too. Like this morning, I got up at 4:30, and I'm happy to do it. I do love real estate, but I love my family more. They're my driver. you've already met Jamie. That's her now 8-year-old son, Nathan, 5-year-old Ellie. They're full of personality and all the craziness and love that kids bring and joy they bring to her life. So disclosures. I'm not a financial advisor. I'm not a CPA. I'm not an attorney. I am a licensed realtor in Texas, and I'm also a real estate agent doing what I'm about to show you. So everything that I show you here, I don't necessarily share this to say do exactly what I'm saying, but take it and filter it with your own goals, your own risk tolerance, run it by your own professionals, your own CPA and all that, figure out how it can help you meet your real estate goals faster than maybe you were anticipating, or maybe a better way, or in a way that is more impactful. So thumbs up or heart in the chat. Now, have you read this book, Cashflow Quadrant? I was in college when I read it, and it was massively impactful. I think at this point, I had already taken accounting class in college. I earned my C, meaning it was a struggle, but I finally got it. And then I read this book later on, and I was like, well, I learned more about accounting just from this book. And then I did a whole semester in accounting class. And this book cost me like $15. But so most people watching now, the concepts in this book, they're very elementary. But what makes this book special is how it outlines money and cash flow in its simplest way, how it's made. It illustrates how money flows. It shows the importance of not only buying assets, but buying assets that provide passive income. There's only so many hours a day that we can work as a professional, and assets that provide passive income produce a compounding effect on our financial statement. And real estate is one of the best income producing assets that you can ever own. And the cool thing is anybody can do it. Like it doesn't take a certain college education or a certain education or background or whatever. Anybody can do this. So understanding that, wealth really becomes better defined as time. When you have more passive income coming in each month than your expenses, your wealth continuously grows. Otherwise, wealth declines. And the unfortunate part is, in a traditional retirement plan how the normal America, normal financial planners are out there that are designing these financial plans, they're really designing a plan to where your wealth decreases every single month. And the goal there is not a goal that I want to live. The goal is to die before you run out of money. And that's just not the pressure I really want to have on my life. I plan on living until I'm 120. I was joking with someone in another thread earlier today about that. So I want to have my wealth grow every single month. And you can do that. This is well understood by a lot of investors, but most investors run their business in a way that looks like this chart, where you have money coming in and that's all being sucked out because of expenses. And the job is they're flipping everything. They're wholesaling everything. Or if you're a realtor, you're working everything as you're getting all of your income through commissions. And there's nothing wrong with any of those things. Like everyone needs some sort of active income until they can get enough passive income that exceeds their expenses. So you still need that. Those are important. But what I'm going to illustrate is there's a big reward to not sell everything. Find a way to hold more assets. The landlord enjoys most of the benefits out there that the government puts out there for you, and not just the government, the government from a tax standpoint, but also enjoying the equity pay down from your tenants, the cash flow, the appreciation, and then the leverage. So you can even turn marginal deals that you would never buy, into big profit. So I'll show you a case study in just a minute, but here's the strategy. Most of you are familiar with the Burr strategy. So there's a slight twist that we put on it, and we call this the slow flip strategy. First, the Burr strategy, buy, starts with buy. You're out there buying a deal below value because it probably needs a lot of work. So you're going to need to rehab it, right? You got to bring it up to value to meet your to meet the market, where whether you're going to buy, rent it or flip it. Either way, you have to rehab it to that condition. But with a burr strategy, the whole purpose is to rent it out. So you get a tenant in there, paying your mortgage, then you refinance. You don't necessarily have to wait until you rent it to refinance. You can refinance day one, or as soon as you're done rehabbing it, but refinance into your long-term lower rate mortgage, then you repeat. That's the burr strategy. But the little twist we have on it, that the reason why we call it the slow flip, is then you sell, which seems a little counterintuitive. Why would you sell if you're trying to build a rental portfolio? And it ends up being a reinvestment of equity to compound results over time. And if you can do this, you're basically flipping properties. It's just not every 90 days or 120 days or every 6 months. You're flipping a property over a 3, 5, 7, 10 year timeline. And that's where you can get some huge, huge numbers. So real life example right now, 7315 Willow Oak. This is the 100K example, where I got the title of this presentation. So this is a house we bought at the end of 2020. It was a complete disaster. What emoji best describes this image right here? Here's another one. So this was actually one of, we flipped 200 houses, which means I've probably gone on more than 1,000 appointments. This was the worst one, the absolute worst house that I've ever personally walked. Not only was it a hoarder house, but it was like a hoarder house that a tornado went off inside, and was there was not a place you could walk inside the house and not step on something. I was just very thankful that whatever I stepped on didn't move, because I didn't know what rats and other things would be lurking underneath the rubble. But we turned it into this. Remarkable. It's a night and day difference. Now, had we flipped this property, we would have made about $10,000. That's not an that doesn't get me excited. For all the work that we put into this deal, that definitely would, I would have been pretty let down with that. But we didn't. And we actually never planned to, but I ran this number because I wanted to illustrate specifically to illustrate to folks that are flipping, because we flipped 200 houses. I mean, this is the thought process I go through now. Had we not done that, like, where would we be? And of course, now we can make a change and do this in the future. This is what I'm trying to get you to understand. If you're out there wholesaling and flipping, or if you want to move into that, find a way to hold more assets. Because what is this $10,000 flip going to turn into? Well, this is a cash flow performa chart. We ended up getting $1,750 a month. It was actually a little bit more than we had planned in rent. All we have to do now is let time play out. So cash flow, net cash flow, I mean, assuming there's no major issues, which those happen, but we also have CapEx, vacancy, and repairs factored in here. But assuming no like major issues, knock on wood, hopefully we don't want to get any floods or anything like that. Look what happens in year 5. Like, cash flow grows slightly over time. It's not going to be a lot, definitely not life-changing, but look what happens in year 5. When we have a projected sale at the end of a 5-year period, we stand to walk away with a $91,000 check based on performance. And the way we underwrote this is, if appreciation does not continue like the crazy appreciation we've had over the last 2 years. So now, after you factor in acquisition costs and disposition costs and commissions and net cash flow over the years, we will end up having net out, based on these projections, about $87,000. What if you had one of these every single year, or two of these every single year? How would that feel? If you could build your pipeline now and have this going on every single year. But it actually gets better, because we didn't flip it. We held it long-term. Therefore, we have lower taxes on the deal. It's now a long-term capital gain. We enjoy depreciation on our tax benefits over the years. So we get an accelerated use out of our dollar. And it actually has appreciated a lot faster than we originally anticipated. Matter of fact, just in the last like 6 months, it's gone up another 20 grand from when we looked at it last year. So it, in all likelihood, is going to be well over $100,000 gross or net at the end of a 5-year period, maybe even as fast as year four if this continues. So you may be saying, hey, that's all projection. So in your pocket, what about an actual deal? Well, I got a couple of those too. 2730 Mesquite. Previous speaker, Jet Lending, they actually loaned on this deal. So this was done with hard money. This was Jamie and I's very first house. We bought this place. It wasn't as trash as the other one. It definitely smelled that bad, though. It was horrible. But anyway, that's when we bought it. We ended up rehabbing it, rented it out, refinancing the long term. We do much better remodels now. This was our first one, so don't judge us on that. But in any case, what our objective was really just to rehab it to meet the comps, and we accomplished that goal and rented it out. It was great. But then the time came to sell it. And really what happened in this case was taxes. It was appreciating so quickly that the taxes and insurance, the increase in cost was eating away with cash flow. So our margins were decreasing. So we decided to go ahead and sell it. So we did. And so we bought this house for $85,000, put $65,000 into it between the initial rehab and then the final make ready at the end. Given it, and then over that time, we had a net cash flow of $14,000. And we sold it for $237,000. I was already licensed at the time, so I did list this. Had we flipped the house, we would have made about $25,000 or $30,000, which that's a decent flip. It's not like super exciting, but it's a decent flip. We ended up making $100,000. That's really good. That actually excites me. And again, it was lower taxes, and we got depreciation along the way, which we had full-time jobs still during that time period. So the tax benefit was massive. Another case study, 5806 Hoover. This house we had bought, it was a HUD home. Whatever the case was before, when we bought it, it really didn't need a lot of work. It was almost like a home run deal for us. We ended up having to put a roof on it and do some little knickknack stuff. But since it was move-in ready, we actually didn't really do much on the interior. Rented it out, then, refinanced. Similar story to the other one. The area is moving up in value. Taxes are going up, insurance going up. Therefore, net income is going down. So we decided to sell it. And so we do. Numbers on this, $80,500. That was the purchase price. We put about $36,000 in it throughout the time we owned it. Net cash flow, almost $13,000. We sold it for $224,000. And it given us a gross profit of almost $120,000. When had we flipped it? About $30,000. Again, $30,000, $120,000. Like, which would you rather have? And the cool thing was, this was actually pretty close in time to the other one. So we ended up having some like fat paydays all in a row, which was nice. All right. So the game plan. Do you want to hear the game plan? The actual game plan that anyone can do, whether you're brand new in this business or you're experienced or regardless. Anyone can do this, because the truth is, if you want to build $1 million rental portfolio, it doesn't take as much as you think. A lot of people think that they have to go do what Ben's doing, buy these huge, huge, large multifamily properties, or they got to go flip 100 homes a year like Don. Those are great things, and you can do them, and you can make a ton of money. But if you are happy, especially if you're happy working a full-time job, just doing your thing, and accumulating rental properties over time, it doesn't take as many as you might think to supplement or even provide the majority of your retirement. So let's go over it. These numbers, I have to work with something, and every market's going to be a little different. And I've got to work with static numbers to keep it simple. But just to illustrate a point, I'm going to show this game plan with a hypothetical property that is worth $175,000 ARV. Again, I mean, if you're in San Diego, California, then like you can't even get a spot next to a gutter worth that. But just play with me here and or work with me here, and you can fill in your own numbers and play this out in your market and see how it plays out. But I guarantee you, it does play out. So ARV 175,000, loan 75%, 131,000, rent following the 1% rule, 1750 a month, PITI. Now this is based on 5% interest, which you can get, at least for now, you can still get much better than 5% interest rate. But PITI 1268, 10% cash reserves, because you have to reserve for taxes and insurance, or you have to reserve for vacancy, repairs, and CapEx, and then cash flow. So that leaves us with a net cash flow of $307. So what we're going to do is we're going to buy one of these properties a year. One property a year. Anyone can do that. Go out, and this is 2022. Buy one rental. That's all you have to do. Now, if you're flipping and you need to flip because you have to make money, right? That's fine. Flip three houses, hold one. Flip three, hold one. Find a way to get one rental property. And if you can't, because of credit reasons or whatever, get in personally, JV on a deal. Matt was talking about how he's used joint venture. We use joint venture on our first deals. Joint venture with someone who can help you and can fill that gap with something that you lack, whether it's money, credit, deal flow. Maybe you have the money and someone else has the deal flow. Find a way to get involved and get your first rental this year. But this is what we're going to do. If you bought one rental this year, you're going to have $307 in cash flow based on this example and $43,000 in equity. Cannot retire off of this. So congrats, you got a rental, but you can't retire. Buy one a year and do that consistently for the next 10 years. So this time when we're doing the 12th annual Invested Agent Summit or whatever, in 10 years from now, when you're looking back, you have 10 rental properties. This is what that would look like. You're a millionaire. So you'd have 10 rental properties paying you a net $3,000 a month. That's not life-changing. Well, actually, that is life-changing for a lot of people. You're probably not going to quit your job off $3,000 a month, especially with inflation. But that can be life-changing for a lot of people. I definitely realize that. And you have almost $500,000 in equity. But here's the secret. You're already a millionaire. You just have to let your tenants pay off the mortgage. That's all you have to do, because it doesn't even factor in appreciation, and it doesn't even factor in debt pay down. So you actually have more equity than you think at year 10, but once your tenants pay them off, if they do not appreciate at all in value, you have $1.75 million in real estate assets that are now generating more income every single month because, you know, you paid off the mortgage. But the truth is, they are going to go up in value. So in a 10-year period, some of them may have doubled in value during that time. But a lot of them probably went up between 20 and 40%. Now, if you want to get aggressive with it, what if you use the slow flip strategy? That was a static example, just buying one a year. What if you use a slow flip strategy where you bought a property for every year for 5 years? But starting in year six, you sold the worst one, the one that just gave you the biggest headache, the one you didn't like, maybe the one that it just went up a lot in value and you're not making cash flow from it anymore. What does that look like? So over a 10-year period, you buy 10, but year 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, you sold one each of those years. So you still ended up selling 5, but you use the money not to go out and buy a Range Rover or buy yourself a significantly bigger house, but you reinvested it, not back into just one property, but use the money to reinvest in two properties, doubling each one you sold. So when you sold one, you bought two. So you ended up selling 5, but buying 10 more. Now you have 15. Now your cash flow is $4,600 a month with $656,000 in equity, but you really have $2.63 million assets under management. Like, that, how's that going to impact your retirement? Now, what if you bought two a year? What does that look like? You bought 20 throughout the 10-year period. You sold 10. So you sold two, your 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, each of those years, sold two, but doubled them. You used the money to go replace the two and then buy two more. So now you actually have 30 at the end of 10 years, $9,200 in cash flow, $1.31 million in equity, $4.5 million assets under management. Finally, if you want to be super, super aggressive, by 3 a year, you end up having 45 properties over a 10-year period, 13,000 plus in monthly cash flow, almost 2 million in equity. But you actually have close to $8 million assets under management. And the assets under management, again, it assumes that they didn't go up in value at all, but they do. And like that, there's not anyone here that can't retire off $8 million. Inflation would have to do a lot of, it would have to have a major impact for that not to work for you. So you probably got a pretty good retirement if you're retiring with $8 million. So how can you do it in 3 years? You only need six properties. That's it. Six properties, based on this example, you would have $1.5 million assets under management. Let your tenants pay them off. That's two properties a year, or just one property. Two properties a year if you want to do it in 3 years. But I mean, if you do it in 6 years, like, would you be sad about that? If you just bought one property a year for 6 years and paid it off, and then they're going to go up in value. So, and in reality, in a lot of markets, two, three, four properties will probably get you there. So a couple of key points here. You have to know your numbers. You got to manage like a pro, which for most people, that means let them pro manage them. That means you don't manage them yourself. Let a professional manage them. There's a lot of great property management companies out there. A lot of them flat fee now, like Renter's Warehouse is a national franchise. I know the owner here in Houston. So reach out to them, or if they're not in your market, someone like them, and or talk to a few, get some referrals. Unless you're going to be actively engaged in managing and you just happen to like it, you don't mind the Friday, Saturday calls that the AC went out and they got a clogged toilet, because it always happens on Fridays and Saturdays. Like, let a professional manage it. That way you can do the fun things, like manage the deposits come into your bank account. Financing. Have to stay on top of your financing. You got to stay on top of your books, which brings me to accounting. Don't do your own bookkeeping. Let a professional handle that. It's not very expensive, and it's going to cost you a lot more money having a CPA fix your problems, which actually means don't do your own taxes. Don't be going on TurboTax. Like the professionals here with bookkeeping and having a real estate professional CPA, do your accounting. They're gonna far more than pay for themselves, and then that way you can focus on things that you're good at doing or you like doing. And then escrow, you have to escrow for taxes and insurance. Your mortgage is probably gonna require that, but they're probably not gonna require that you escrow for vacancy and repairs and capital expenditures. Well, you will have vacancies at some point. If you hold it a certain amount of time, it will be vacant at some point. You will have repairs. Things happen. And there's going to be some type of big capital expense, a roof, an HVAC system, a water heater, whatever. You need the money to pay for that stuff. So you may be able to absorb just one. But if you've got three or four that happen all at once and you got to absorb those, that wouldn't be fun. So have the money. Keep it in a separate bank account. And that way you can... you don't get caught. And then last, reinvest. You got to reinvest the funds. That's the only way you're going to grow a portfolio if you're spending everything you're making, which can be tempting if you look at Instagram and all the folks that are in fake jets taking pictures. It's not real. You know it's fake. Like, don't try to live like the Joneses do, because the Joneses are broke too. You're not. You're reinvesting. And then in 10, 20 years, you're not taking pictures in front of a jet. If you want one, you could buy one. Probably don't even need to do that too, because that's how you got rich. You reinvested everything, right? So here's how to reach us, investagents.com.